Englanders who have a passion for performing, and visit an historic deaf church in the heart of New York City. We'll reveal the driving force behind a Southern school for deaf children and introduce you to a woman who helps you borrow money easily. Next on Deaf Mosaic. Hello, welcome to Deaf Mosaic. I'm Gil Eastman. Today's program highlights people who live in the eastern region of the United States and their contributions to the deaf community. The power of music has influence and impact on the hearing world. Patriotism is displayed to the tune of a Sousa march. The new year doesn't begin until someone sings Auld Lang Syne, and the Beach Boys conjure up images of surfing and lost youth. Music is definitely a large part of American culture. Well, meet one group in Connecticut who mix music and drama in their performances. This is Hartford, the capital of Connecticut, a city famous for establishing the first school for the deaf, and a city famous for giving birth to the Cridders. What's a Cridder?
This is what I want, right here. Look at this. That's what I want. We've all practiced very hard. I think we're ready. I think it's going to be great. One of our best shows, honest. Triple Cridders, right? One of our best shows. Good luck. Take it easy out there. No problem. Merry Christmas. The Cridders originally were a group of friends, interpreters, that I invited to my house one night in the summertime and asked them, do you want to have a show?
It's a group made up of maybe 8 to 10 individuals, depending on some staying or retiring or moving or motherhood or some reason in and out.
Well, the group is made up of a variety of different people and personalities. Most of them are connected to deafness in some way.
The group of the Cridders is a signing group, and we take music and make it visual on the stage for deaf and for hearing audiences.
My name is Vincey. I work for the Commission on the Deaf and Hearing Impaired in Hartford. I'm the son of deaf parents, and I work as vocational specialist here. I get involved with anything that's related to employment, job placement, job problem resolution, filing cases of discrimination. One of the things that the Cridders offers me is an opportunity for deaf people in the population to see me in a different light. Most of the time they see me as a person who is around when there's a problem, when there's trouble. They see Vincey as a problem.
What do I do here? I teach junior high school, high school, social studies. I've been in the group since it was started way back 1979. And well, what we try to do for every song is add a twist and add our interpretation of what we think some of the songs, what they look like. For example, one song we've done 13 different ways. I would like to think that, you know, we are the four runners to MTV. We are doing this and changing thing to make it look live. And we add a little comedy. There's a story behind the song and movement. For our Christmas show, we have a Christmas sign along. With the Christmas show, we turn on the house lights and then we get everybody involved, and there's some of the members of the group go into the audience and just make that contact with the people. And of course, when you're on the stage, you always make the eye contact with the people so that they feel that they are in the show.
My name is Tommy Meehan, and I've worked here at the American School for the Deaf since 1977. I always tease people that I came when I was a baby. The Cridders, which was a group of people that I saw for the first time in 1977 when I came here, and hoped that someday I would be fortunate enough to join them. In the beginning, most of the audiences that we attracted were deaf people, students of sign language, and that still is who we attract today. But because of national media, like, you know, Children of a Lesser God movies, The Bridge to Silence that was recently made, the interest in sign language has broadened so that now we're attracting what we call the theater-going public. I was born deaf, but we didn't know until I was five. And in my father's family of 10, they all sang. And my mother's family of 8, they each and the parents played a different musical instrument. I have no brothers and sisters, and I think it was just a natural thing that I would either sing or play, and I can't sing. So I developed an interest in the piano, and quickly my parents sent me to a school, a teacher. It's a funny kind of talent to have in a deaf brain.
Started out as a music and movement instructor at the American School for the Deaf. I'll be starting soon as a sign language coordinator, and I will still remain a part-time interpreter for the state of Connecticut. In the beginning, when this first was established, I selected most of the music with the musical editor, who has quite a library of music in his house. I would first select a theme, and then we would try to find music to match the themes of the shows. Some of the selections of music were difficult because they were rock and roll and country and western music, different varieties of music. I now presently still write the basic outline for the show, present it to the group, select most of the music, and at this point, after 13 years, I allow them to be creative with the characters I assign them. We rehearse every Sunday night. I have myself personally missed a lot of family events. I've missed birthday parties. My husband has had to miss the Super Bowl football games many Sundays because of Corita rehearsal. Mother's Day, Father's Day. We rehearse every Sunday for 13 years. It's a big commitment.
The Gallaudet family has played a major role in the shaping of deaf America. They've helped establish schools, organizations, and even churches for deaf people. Next is a story about a Gallaudet institution that has provided community and religious leadership for almost 150 years. These sights in New York are so familiar they need no explanation. Others are not. This is St. Anne's Church for the Deaf, the oldest church for the deaf in America. Originally located on the corner of Fifth Avenue and West 18th Street, this Episcopalian church had been providing spiritual leadership long before the Civil War started. Documenting this history is author Henry L. Buzzard, a lay reader of St. Anne's Church.
The church was started in 1852 by Dr. Reverend Thomas, no middle name, Gallaudet. He was the oldest son of Thomas Hopkins Gallaudet. Although its official name is St. Anne's Church for the Deaf, the congregation was comprised of hearing people and deaf people, and separate worship services were offered to these groups on Sundays.
In a very short time, St. Anne's became a community and cultural center for the deaf people of New York, although its services and activities were coordinated under the protective umbrella of the Episcopalian diocese. Deaf people of all faiths chose St. Anne's as their house of worship. At the turn of the century, St. Anne's neighborhood developed into a booming business district, and the church sold its property without consulting and against the wishes of its deaf members. Heated arguments ensued. Fist fights broke out between hearing and deaf members. Deaf church identity was lost. But Reverend Gallaudet provided the leadership to build a new church for the deaf parishioners. The building was designed with an inclined floor toward the altar, allowing each member to see clearly over the heads of those sitting before them. And additional lighting was wired overhead, so the signed worship could be seen throughout the sanctuary. Reverend Gallaudet watched this church grow from a handful of deaf people to a large, active deaf congregation. But by 1949, hard times had fallen on St. Anne's. The neighborhood was changing once again. The membership was dwindling, and they could no longer afford the operating expenses and maintenance fees of the building. For the second time in its history, St. Anne's Church for the Deaf was sold. It has never built nor purchased its own building since that time. The transient congregation now meets and worships in borrowed facilities, and for the past 5 years, they have had no priest to call their own.
At last, there is me, a deaf lay reader. I'm not a priest. So?
Ernest Marshall, a filmmaker for 50 years, has been a member of St. Anne's since the early 1920s.
I was born deaf. I prefer a deaf preacher. We relate. And the signing's clearer. It makes me feel comfortable during the service.
As older congregations become smaller, deaf parishioners have little choice but to travel greater distances to worship, like Mildred and Griffin Fitzhugh, who were married in St. Anne's 50 years ago.
The Brooklyn Episcopal Church closed. So we had to come back to this church again.
These octogenarians may not see St. Anne's Church for the Deaf move into the 21st century, but they are hopeful.
We want the church to remain open, to stay forever. We want to grow and for new deaf people to come to our church.
It's really my belief that the church can keep going. It stood for 138 years. It's the mother of all deaf churches. It will continue. I really believe that.
The itinerant priest Roy Brown explains.
St. Anne's is trying to find a full-time priest to minister here. And it's hard. There are not many priests who really are interested in deaf ministry now, more and more are becoming interested, and hopefully soon we will find a full-time priest.
The church is an important part of the deaf community. I wish I could help, but I'm old.
For most of us, it's hard to resist the innocence and smile of a small child. They steal our hearts away. When one little deaf girl stole the hearts of a Virginia couple, her needs inspired them to tackle the social and economic barriers to her education. When the first deaf schools opened in the United States, slavery was in force in the South, and with rare exceptions, African American children, hearing and deaf, were denied the right to an education. Soon after the abolition of slavery, state legislatures established a racially segregated public school system in the South. In 1895, an African-American woman, whose name is not known, tried to enroll her deaf daughter in the Virginia School for the Deaf, which was a school for white children. At the time, unlike most other southern states, Virginia had no school for African-American deaf children. The school refused to admit her daughter and suggested that the mother meet with William C. and Mary Alice Ritter, graduates of the Virginia School, and leaders in the deaf community in Staunton, Virginia. The Ritters were advocates of education for African-American deaf children. They met, and the Ritters agreed to educate her daughter until a school could be set up. William Ritter immediately began to lobby the state legislature for the establishment of a school. His effort took 8 years, but after many delays, he secured the funding. In 1909, the Virginia State School for Colored Deaf and Blind Children opened its doors to 20 students. And who was elected to be the school's first superintendent? William C. Ritter. Gang violence is again on the rise in major cities, frustrating the attempts of counselors and social workers to help teens lead productive lives. Pedro Acevedo is an ex-member of a deaf gang and has counseled troubled gang members.
Deaf Mosaic's Larry Burke talked to Pedro in our studio.
Thank you for coming here today. You're a counselor with deaf youth gangs in New York City. In the past, there were articles about your work published. What is happening now with those gangs?
It's different now than in the past. This year, crime has increased tremendously. It used to be different in the past. For example, I remember during previous times, they kept their crimes a secret. Then the gangs started to grow, and the hearing gangs grew too. Both groups were arrested for robbery and fighting. It was the same for the deaf and the hearing. They were taken to court. The courts found it difficult to communicate with members of deaf gangs. The court sentenced hearing gang members to 2 years and deaf gang members to 5 years. It was puzzling. What was the difference between the two gangs? They were very much alike. I started to investigate this and then got involved in legal research. I was able to discover many things. And the newspaper articles helped me make them aware there was no difference.
Can you give us an example of your experience?
I learned from seeing it all while I was growing up. I was involved, too. I was involved in gangs myself. From that, I became a counselor. I saw mistakes that made gang members suffer. I saw there was a need. I didn't quit, but I stepped out so I have a better perspective. Where was I going? There was no one to help, so I did it myself and was successful. I got what I wanted. Now I see my old gang, and they see what I've done.
Because you had those experiences, you relate to them better than people without that experience?
Yes, it's true. That's important because you should know how they feel. You grew up together, and you can understand what they mean. If someone tries to get away with something, I can tell them, come on, I know what you're doing. Because of my different perspective now, we can really trust each other. They can use more tough reality talk with me because I'm like them. If they want to give me a hard time, they might try to get me to feel fear, but they can't. They plan to do various things. It's fine with me. But they don't realize I have many friends in the deaf community. If he talks about me, my friends would tell him, no, no, I know him well. So I say, I won't hurt you. You won't hurt me. Are you trying to scare me? It won't work. I understand their talk.
Are there several separate gangs or one large gang?
Really, there are two. You mean today?
Today.
Oh, there are 8 different groups. My old gang is still in existence, but it has been passed on to newer members. It's been handed down little by little with tips on how to do things the right way. Old-timers have experiences that younger members can learn from, with advice and warnings. In time, the younger members improve and begin to accept the advice.
Why do they have these problems? How can they improve? What do they need?
They need improvement in understanding what their basic responsibilities are, to show some initiative. They shouldn't be given lollipops and be led around by the hand. They need to learn how to find out things for themselves, find a job, deal with the courts, like hearing people do. Most are weak and afraid because they're deaf. That's silly. If I can go through it, you can too. They know they have freedom, and there's nothing wrong with that, and it doesn't hurt. They shield themselves and are afraid. Now with exposure to older deaf families, they see it can be done. They ask, can I do it? I say yes. From then on, they can move on and succeed.
When these kids and gangs who get in trouble and meet you, a deaf counselor, do they feel comfortable dealing with you as opposed to hearing counselors? Are there any problems dealing with either one?
From my experience, they relate better with deaf counselors because of these important factors: culture, environment, and their background and ways. Knowing this is very important and helps you to know details. If he was with a hearing counselor, even if the counselor was good with sign, how could he understand what the kid means? The counselor and the kid view things differently. Sometimes the counselor can work with the kid, but still miss meanings. I don't feel they are always communicating. That's the reason I make sure to get involved. This way, they can ask more questions in depth.
Wonderful. And I hope deaf youth from all over will look at you and understand and begin to share their feelings with their deaf counselors. Thank you for the information.
Pedro is currently augmenting his education by attending Gallaudet University, but plans to continue his work in the future. It's been said that there are 3 things you don't talk to people about: religion, politics, and money. This story has nothing to do with religion or politics, but it does have to do with money and purchasing the American dream. For most, buying a home is the largest investment they will make. Choosing the right loan, locking in an interest rate, and getting through the applications can make purchasing that home a nightmare. Debbie Shaw, America's first deaf loan officer, is turning that nightmare into the American dream.
The difficulty deaf people faced before I became a bank loan officer was having to rely on a third party to communicate. There was a communication barrier. Our clients need to be able to have conversations with someone they trust. They want the confidentiality of a one-to-one interaction.
After resigning her position as an accountant with the U.S. Department of the Navy, Debbie was hired by the Northern Virginia-based First Savings Mortgage Company. In today's economy, interest rates and regulations change almost daily, and being able to understand those changes is difficult, according to Larry Pratt, president of First Savings Mortgage.
The mortgage lending environment now is very complex. There is so many choices a consumer has for financing, the type of loan, refinancing, things of that nature. So it's difficult even for those that don't have the hearing impairment. The thing that Debbie does offer is the communication bridge, and can obviously explain and hopefully give comfort and assurance to the potential customer.
With new home construction slowing and resale prices dropping, Debbie uses the latest technology to maintain a constant link between realtors and prospective home buyers, hoping to take advantage of the current buyer's market. Spending most of her time meeting with local realtors, she admits that many of them were both surprised and relieved by her career choice.
There are about 20 realtors that work with deaf clients and know sign language and have a TDD. They were surprised when I first called them and informed them of my services as a loan officer. They said, wow, that's great, because it solves the problem of always having to rely on a third party from the initial application to closing the deal. I see myself in the future being able to help deaf home buyers, making it a good experience for them.
We've come to the close of today's program, where we visited the eastern part of our country. Until next time, when Deaf Mosaic brings you more stories from around our world, I'm Gil Eastman. So long.